Welcome to CAF Homeopathy Study Group webinar. We provide excellence in educational purpose of holistic approach by conducting professional homeopathic webinars that provides continuing educational credits to practitioners following principles of classical homeopathy. This study group is dedicated to provide moral support to stage 4 cancer survivors. We value and treasure human collective as our honorable peers. We bring world-renowned homeopaths to our webinars. This is Kavita Kukunur from Michigan, USA, President and CEO of Kavita Holistic Approach, Board Certified Homeopath and Outreach Coordinator of CHC PR Committee. I'm a member of Kevin Friendly Foundation, non-profit organization that helps to serve poor people in greater needs in India. I thank Homeopathy Study Group leadership and all the volunteers for their support. This webinar is moderated by Dr. Deepak Sharma, Dr. Sweta Singh, and Professor Regina Rianelli. This webinar is for educational purpose only. It is being recorded as we speak, and we are live on FB. Today, our honorable guest speaker is eminent homeopath Dr. Faruk Master, who speaks about homeopathic management in advanced lung cancer, stage 3 and 4. Everyone knows Dr. Faruk Master. No introduction is needed. He is a very busy homeopathic practitioner with over 40 years of experience. He has treated and supervised several thousands of patients, including serious and life-threatening cases. Dr. Master is the only homeopathic MD consulting at Asia's largest allopathic hospital, Mumbai Hospital Institute of Medical Sciences. He is also a professor in homeopathy and author of numerous books in the field. He has completed his MD as a gold ranker in tumors and homeopathy. Dr. Master is a PhD with his research in evolution of clinical metrimedica through cancer cases. It was very nice to meet Dr. Faruk Master this year virtual at JAHC Global Summit on Pandemics and Pain, and also in person at JAHC conference in 2018 at Phoenix, Arizona. He is very kind, generous, and a great healer. Thank you so much, Dr. Master, for your precious time and accepting my invitation. Let us welcome Dr. Faruk to our webinar. Please go ahead, sir.
Hi.
And also, in order to receive continuing educational certificate, you need to fill the chat form, which is going to be provided in the chat. Thank you. So, can you share the screen, sir?
Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Kavita. So today we are going to discuss stage 3 and stage 4 advanced lung cancer and the homeopathic management for the same. So first of all, let us understand some philosophical aspect. Every organ in our human body is connected with some emotions. Okay? Ancient Eastern civilization have long understood the way our mental and spiritual bodies inform our physical nature. Western science too has begun to understand the interdependence between the emotion and the physical body. In emotions and physical health are intimately connected. The integrated mind-body approach to health and healing operates in a dynamic loop where emotions impact the health of the body and vice versa. Now, this is so unique to homeopathy and not to modern medicine at all. According to Chinese traditional medicine, excessive irritability and anger can affect the liver and result in multiple ailments, including menstrual pain, headaches, redness of face and eyes, dizziness, and dry mouth. Alternatively, imbalances in the liver can result in a stormy moods. So here I'm showing you some organs and the emotions that are attached with that. So anger we can correlate with liver, fear with kidney, joy with the heart, sadness and grief with the lungs and worry with the spleen. Now, I have also studied Steiner's medicine, what we call as anthroposophy. And in anthroposophy also, we have got emotions that are connected to the shape of the organs of the body. Since in homeopathy, we do a long exhaustive case taking, it's very important that you should bring out some emotional causes in every cancer patients that you see and correlate that with a particular organ and understand the pathology that is happening within the organ. The lungs bring oxygen into the body and remove carbon dioxide. In traditional Chinese medicine, it is connected to the grief, sadness, and detachment. Very recently, I was treating a case of a very famous artist in India. He was a very celebrated painter and a chronic smoker for many years, finally develops lung cancer, takes the modern allopathic treatment, better for some time, and then recurrences and then metastasis, and then comes to the terminal stage. He was then put on anti-epithelial growth factor, targeted chemotherapy, develops severe side effects of that, and so stops all the allopathic medicine and is looking for a healing in a naturopathic way. We took his history. The biggest sadness and the grief in his life was birth of a handicapped child. The patient was around 65 years old, but he had a 20-year-old son who suffers from Duchenne muscular dystrophy and he's bedridden. He had a constant grief and sadness about the handicapped child. So the lung got affected. Within the lung, his main complaint was breathlessness and cough. I'm going to discuss with you later on how I analyzed those symptoms. Finally, we came to Lycopodium as a remedy, which covered beautifully all his symptoms. For 6 months, we treated him with Lycopodium and practically reduced his coughing bouts by 75 to 80%. Along with that, the breathlessness improved. He didn't want to go for any further investigations, so we respected his desire. But after 6 months, his health again deteriorated. That was the time we could not help him. And unfortunately, he succumbed to that. But 6 months of palliation that we gave him was fantastic, and only with one remedy, Lycopodium. So what I want to tell you from this case is, see how grief gets connected to lungs, or how sadness gets connected to the lungs. Symptoms of lung imbalances are usually shortness of breath, shallow breathing, sweating, fatigue, cough, frequent cough and cold, allergies, asthma and other lung condition, dry skin, depression and excessive crying. In the Chinese medicine, the qi is deficiency, yin is deficiency, and cold damp obstructing the lungs. Grief is the emotion of the lungs and large intestine, organs associated with metal element. Loss of any kind will often trigger a cold and feeling of being energetically drained and difficult bowel function. grief can stay with us for a while and can go unresolved until we decide to release it. When the grief is unresolved, it becomes chronic depression. Let me tell you another case of a Hindu businessman. He also comes with me with an advanced lung cancer, takes full treatment of chemotherapy and operation. But again, after 1.5 years, gets a massive metastasis. And at that time, doctors are asking him that now no more options are available, excepting you can try the chemotherapy. But he was not very keen. So he comes to us for homeopathic treatment. Now his history goes like this, that he lost a lot of money because he invested his profits into purchasing gold. He bought gold at a very cheaper rate and he thought because the gold prices are increasing, he will make a big profit out of it. Unfortunately, for next few months, the gold prices never increase. Rather, it went down and then suddenly he needed money to liquefy from his investment to enter into another project. And this is where he encountered a big loss. It runs into lakhs of rupees. He went into depression and from depression he developed cancer. He was beautifully managed with a remedy, Aurum Metallicum, which helped him. For 1.5 years, we treated his all individual symptoms of cough, breathlessness, pleural effusion. But finally, after 9 months, he succumbed to that. We could not go beyond that. But that comfortable zone of palliation is very important. Now, let me make a point very clear that stage 3 and 4 patients can't be cured. Huh? Remember that. So don't aim even or don't even think of cure in such advanced cases. If you can palliate somebody for 3 months, 6 months maximum, you are the winner. So keep that in your mind. So to balance this grief and all those things that affects, following foods I always advise. You can see over here almonds, onion, radish, mustard seeds. And we ask patients not to eat fatty foods because that produces a lot of phlegm and congestion in the lungs. Now, lung cancer is a very challenging cancer to treat. Those that are diagnosed at a localized stage, in a very early stage, are usually curable. But unfortunately, those cases don't come for homeopathy. That's the sad part. Most people are diagnosed when the disease has spread outside the chest. That is, it involves the nodes in the chest, regional. And you will see on this statistics, which I have shown you, non-small cell lung cancer survival rate. On the left-hand side, you will see percentage of patient 68. And if you look under the years at the bottom, you will see only 5 months. But if you look them at the 4 years period, only 5% can be alive. So the diagnosis is very bad. Overall 2 years survival rate is only 25%. And at 5 years, it drops to 15%. So this is one disease where there is always, you are going to lose the battle. How you play the game, that is very important. So that is your success, how you play the game. The most commonest type that I see in my practice is NSCLC, non-small cell lung cancer. About 80 to 85%. 75% of my practice are all cancer patients. So basically I deal with them day and night. They usually start in the lining of the body cavities and surfaces. You can see over here in this diagram how it starts, the red color, dark red color. And there are many different kinds of lung cancer. Some are known as adenocarcinoma. They begin in the cell that line the passage of the respiratory tract, that is what is known as squamous cell carcinoma. Sometimes you get a very rare variety, what is known as adenoma carcinoma in situ. It starts in the air sac. Now these carcinomas are not aggressive and may not invade the surrounding tissue. So here you have a good scope of homeopathy for at least minimum 3 to 5 years if you get this kind of cases. But fortunately, these type of cases are very less. So you may not get it so frequently. But if you get it, we have got enough evidence in my practice where this kind of cancer, the survival rate is good and they respond very well to homeopathic medicine. The faster growing types, the cell who takes part in the Olympics, are the large cell neuroendocrine tumors or a small cell lung cancer. Just very recently, I lost a very famous personality in India who had this neuroendocrine tumor in the lungs. He was palliated with a remedy, aurum metallicum, but finally he succumbed. We could not prolong him for more than 5 months. But this small cell lung cancer represents about 20%. It grows much more faster than non-small cell. They respond to chemotherapy, but you cannot cure such patients. So this is where the role of homeopathy comes in small cells and non-small cells. In some cases, both tumors can come together, that is small and non-small cell. Another variety is mesothelioma. I hardly see mesothelioma in India. Maybe once in 4 years, 5 years I see. This is due to asbestos exposure. I'm sure in United States you won't see much because there are so much restriction by the government regarding asbestos. So the percentage may be a little less. But here in India, we see that kind of tumors. Tumors in the lung can grow quite large before you notice them. And that is why early symptoms mimic a common cold or a condition of chronic cough. People don't seek medical attention right away. And that's the reason why lung cancer is usually diagnosed in early stage. I tried to combine some symptoms for my cancer patients. And these are the one in the black. Lingering cough, worsening cough, phlegm or blood in the cough, hoarseness, shortness of breath, fatigue, loss of appetite. All these are common symptoms that I see with small cell lung cancer. Lymph nodes can be enlarged with metastasis. Bones can be involved. Brain or spine can be involved in the liver. So here you will see some symptoms of the common sites of lung metastasis. Mostly it is lymph nodes, you know, followed by liver and then bones. So these are the three areas where it will come and destroy your body if its disease is not under control. Sometimes you get paraneoplastic syndromes. So it can press on a large blood vessel that transport the blood to the head, arms and heart. This can cause swelling of the face, neck, upper chest and arms. And that sometimes the tumor in the lung can manufacture hormone and then produce another variety of symptom called paraneoplastic syndrome. You can look over here. The list is very long. I just included few symptoms: weakness, nausea, vomiting, fluid retention, high blood pressure, diabetes, confusion, and coma. many causes of lung cancer, but the most important is the smoking, 90% of the cause. Small cell lung cancer is almost always associated with heavy smoking. Another very important thing is radon. People who stay basically in a place where there is a high exposure to the gas radon are susceptible to lung cancer. So this is a very important finding that recently we have found out. Radon enters the apartment through the cracks in the foundation. So if you are a smoker and you are exposed to radon, the risk of lung cancer becomes very high. Now, it's just an idea, not a very sure theory, but you have to study radon gas and look for its proving and see if we can use this in patients who are prone to or susceptible to lung cancer. Other substance that can cause lung cancer is arsenic, cadmium, chromium, nickel, uranium. And of course, sometimes you get what is known as genetic mutations and the cancer can come. Biggest risk factor, of course, is what is known as smoking, and you can give up the smoking. But sometimes what I see in my practice is that patient has no risk factor and yet he has a cancer of the lung. Now, this is something very shocking, something very surprising. We really don't know the reason. Tobacco smoke, again. So if you are not directly smoking, but if you are exposed to the tobacco smoke also, if your partner is smoking in the house, this can affect what we call as a secondhand smoke. It produces 7,000 deaths from lung cancer each year. Exposure to radon, I already said to you. Exposure to asbestos, another very big risk for cancer. The fumes, very important. The fumes that come out from the diesel car, that's another very important thing. And radioactive ores like uranium and diesel exhaust is very common. Now, there are some risks which you can change. It is said that having beta-carotene supplements is not very healthy if you are undergoing the chemotherapy for cancer. So this is something which many cancer institutes will ask you not to take beta-carotene supplements. Especially if you are a smoker, you should avoid taking beta-carotene because that makes you prone towards lung cancer. Arsenic in drinking water is another very hazard, health hazard, especially in South Asia, even India, South America. It brings you very close and susceptible to lung cancer. Previous radiation for any other cancer like Hodgkin's disease or breast cancer can also invite what is known as lung cancer at some stage. Pollution in the air, of course, you can't change. 5% of all death from lung cancer may be due to outdoor air pollution. Family history of cancer is always 10%. So if you have a brother or a sister or anybody else in the family, grandparents who have any cancer, especially of lung cancer, it makes you much more prone. This is where I work. These are my hospitals where I have a homeopathic department, as you can see on the left side. On an average, we see 100 cancer patients every month in the hospital. It's very important to discuss the goal of cancer treatment with your homeopaths, whether you are going to treat them only with homeopathy, or homeopathy and surgery, or homeopathy and chemotherapy, or homeopathy and radiation. So only giving homeopathy at stage 3 or stage 4 will be a big joke, I tell you. Because people have already taken all those modalities before they come to you. So only when all these modalities will not work, patients will come to you. But yet, even symptomatically bringing them under control is very, very difficult. And so you will have to take many times the help of modern medicine. And you should not feel shy or embarrassed about it, because well-being of the patient is more important than anything else. If I have to look at the statistic, lung cancer is the commonest cancer and can cause of cancer related to death all over the world. It accounts for 13% of all new cancer cases, 19% of cancer related death worldwide. And there are 1.8 million new cancer cases estimated to occur in 2020. In India, lung cancer constitutes 6.9% of all new cancer cases and 9.3% of all cancer-related death in both the sex. Now, something is very unique in India. We have a state known as Mizoram, and that has the highest incidence of lung cancer. We really don't know. More in the male than the female. So we have to really study why this is happening. Maybe the soil, maybe the water. We really don't know. But maximum, it's a state which is on the northeastern part of India. Research has been done worldwide to find out the best possible chemotherapy. And right now what we are doing is what is known as the newer molecular target or targeted chemotherapy for cancer patients, because within the cancerous cell and the tissue that surrounds the cancerous cell, they have certain proteins, and chemotherapeutic drugs are developed to attack those proteins so that the cell multiplication stops. So this is a very big research which is being going around, and the success rate is pretty good. So in next 10 years to come, maybe the percentage of death will reduce. Next. So this is something on what is known as the designs that act the chemotherapy. Nothing to discuss about. So the best possible thing is operation followed by chemotherapy in most of those cases which are newly diagnosed. Now, what you have to basically pay attention is that when patient comes to you, sometimes the side effects of the treatment are very important to treat than the cancer itself. So many times I spend a lot of time just treating the side effects of the treatment rather than the main cancer. Even for radiation, surgery, pre-surgery, post-surgery, we can use homeopathic medicines. And then in my hospital, we have a what is known as rehab center also for pulmonary rehab. Pain management, how to cease smoking or how to leave the habit of smoking. So now let's go to the homeopathic part. So there are many remedies that come up. There are no specific remedies. So if you are attending my webinar to learn the specific remedies, then this is not a webinar for you. But I have collected some group of remedies which it has been very useful to me. And so I'm going to discuss that with you all. So let us see. Okay. So let's start with the first remedy. It's an Indian herb, Aquila Faya Indica. I usually use when I have too strong indication of this remedy. Weakness when you wake up in the morning with hemoptysis. First you have a dry cough, a very hard variety of cough, and then immediately you start vomiting. So this is the key symptom of this remedy. There can be a severe pain in the chest, burning in the pharynx, esophagus and stomach. It's a pure blood, but remember, usually in the morning aggravation, not evening or anything else. There is a constant irritation in the trachea, which manufactures a dry cough. Cough is extremely violent. There can be night sweats and a history of tuberculosis. Next remedy is arsenic iodide. This is remedy which you can use for multiple cancers. It's not only for lung cancer that I use. Especially if the patient has a tubercular diathesis, hot patient because of the iodium part of it, difficult expectoration, lot of sneezing, patient is usually hungry. Now see, to find hunger in a cancer patient is difficult. But arsenic iodide patient needs food all the time. It is a very good remedy when a person has got tendency to catch cold with thin, watery, irritating, excoriating nasal discharge. Patient is restless like arsenic. And most important thing is that the right upper lung and the right middle part of the lung is affected. There is emaciation and the discharges are acrid. This is what I see. History of repeated pneumonia and cough that ends in vomiting and inability to bring out the sputum. Sputum is very difficult. Another remedy similar to arsenic iodide is stannum iodide, where again it is difficult to bring out the sputum. Congestion in the lung, breathlessness on ascending stairs, past history of ischemic heart disease, and a presence of respiratory failure clinically. I also use this remedy a lot in psoriasis, Hodgkin's lymphoma, and sulfur is the biggest complementary to this remedy, especially in pulmonary affections. Another remedy which I use is Arrhenia diadema, especially for hemorrhage, especially for blood with the sputum, where a person has marked aggravation in the damp weather. There is a lot of periodicity in this remedy, so symptoms appear at a periodic interval. Hemorrhage is bright red. Patient is very chilly. Now here, something unique. Patient is better by smoking. Can you imagine? We just discussed that smoking induces cancer. And now in Arrhenia is one remedy. But remember, the smoking ameliorates the symptom in the head, the symptom of the mind, and not coughing. Huh? This is a remedy mentioned in the literature as an intercurrent remedy when you are treating a case of lung cancer. Anthracinnamon is very important for pain, chest pain. What happens is, in advanced lung cancer, the lymph nodes are enlarged and they start compressing the esophagus, they start compressing the lungs, they start compressing the other soft tissues. As a result, person will have severe chest pain. When you do upper GI endoscopy, you will see that the whole GI tract has been compressed by the mediastinal group of lymph nodes. So when you see excessive swelling of lymph nodes in mediastinum by CT scan, in a case of lung cancer, especially the pain is of a burning type, think of the remedy etrasinam. There can be blood also. Usually there will be a low-grade fever. It is very similar to Natremur, especially the mind, but chilly. And the patient loves sun. That differentiates from Natremur. I use this remedy a lot in cancer of breast also. And especially if there's a family history of cancer, tuberculosis or diabetes. Another remedy is Calicarb. Now, Calicarb I use usually for dry, hard cough at 3 a.m. or midnight after. Stitching pain and dryness of the pharynx is a big concomitant. The medicine works beautifully well when there is a effusion in the lungs. When the patient coughs, the respiration gets arrested. Cold feeling in the chest is the biggest keynote of Calicarb. Cold feeling in the chest. And chest is very sensitive. So if you put the stethoscope, patient is not very comfortable. If you put your hand, the patient is not very comfortable. The expectoration is cheesy taste, offensive. Tendency to tuberculosis, tendency to catch cold, loves warm climate. And the pains are always worse lying on the affected side. Hahnemann says, person suffering from ulceration of the lungs can scarcely get well without the antisoric remedy like Calicarb. Bag-like swelling below the eyelids, excessive flatulency, a backache, weak rapid pulse. These are some of the other keynotes of the remedy. Bleomycin. This is one remedy that I use a lot. Now, it has got what is known as a tubercular background and there is a lot of fibrosis in the lung. So when there's a lot of fibrosis, or I also use for fibrocystic disease of the lung, bleomycin. It's a chemotherapeutic agent. I use it in a potentized form. Noteworthy symptoms are hyperpigmentation, thickened skin, thickened nails, and lot of enlargement of cervical lymph nodes, and there has to be a lot of metastasis, and dyspnea is even at rest. Remitis vesicular. This is another very important intercurrent remedy. Does not have many indications to tell you or to share with you, but this is, you can just use it as an intercurrent remedy. Lycopodium, it's a very big remedy. The characteristic is it has got a tickling cough like Rumex and constriction and burning in the chest. Cough is worse while going a downhill and it is very deep and hollow. Night cough, as if there are sulfur fumes in the trachea and lot of rattling mucus. Natrum sulf, especially if you are a victim of a damp weather, especially if you are holding the chest while coughing, and if you have some liver symptoms, liver concomitants like bitter taste, lack of appetite, cannot digest fatty food. It matches the picture of sometimes jaundice or liver metastasis with lung cancer. We go to next remedy, Stenum metallicum. Sternum metallicum is very important when there is an excessive prostration and weakness. So when you ask the patient, how are you feeling? The patient will say, I am better. I am not better. He can't even speak. Voice does not come out. That kind of weakness in the chest, that kind of prostration. Cough is usually loose and green. Severe debility and worst early morning, so 3 a.m., 4 a.m., and greenish expectorations like Lycopodium or Kali Sulf or Pulsatilla. Constant desire to take deep breath and pneumonia that do not resolve easily. That's very important. And every cold enters the lung. These are some of the indications of sternum. Thick yellow tongue. Must hold the chest while coughing. Mangum acetatum. Especially if cough is attended with chronic hoarseness and lying down ameliorates everything, is a classic keynote of mangum acetatum. There is a hemoptysis also, but difficult to bring out the mucus, and history of tuberculosis, especially of the respiratory tract, and especially the larynx, and worse in damp weather. Prunus spinosa, compensatory hypertrophy and wheezing when walking, oppression of the chest, anxiousness, short respiration, but most important is the compensatory hypertrophy, especially of the heart. Because of the lung disease, there is wheezing, worse motion, worse exertion, worse walking. Angina pectoris, but most important is slightest motion, slightest walking produces severe palpitation and discomfort in the chest. Withania somnifera. You have to use this in a very, very last stage when person is going to die and there are no more hopes. I learned this remedy from Ayurvedic literature. It is very similar to ginseng. And usually to calm down the patient, if patient is restless, if patient is depressed, to boost him up a little bit, induce him a good sleep, if he's sleepless due to any discomfort. This is the remedy I basically use as a homeopathic euthanasia in advanced lung cancer. Not many symptoms, but inflammations, infectious disease and tumor are other indications of the remedy. Helix tosta. When nothing works for stopping the hemorrhage from the lungs, I use helix tosta. I use it in a very low potency, 6x or so. Every time he coughs, he spits blood. And there is a hoarseness and aggravation is in the night. Clark cured many cases with this remedy in CM potency. So you should read Clark's dictionary for this remedy. Dyspnea ascending stairs, hemorrhagic tendency. Another very important remedy that I use, and I would like to thank Dr. Sunimal Sarkar from Calcutta to show me this remedy. And the name of the remedy is Saurusya Slapa. It's an Indian herb, what is known as Kut root. It has got many medicinal uses. One of the very powerful anti-cancer remedy. And the main indication is cough better by drinking water. That's the keynote. Especially if there's an acute cough. cough better by drinking water is a very important symptoms. If you see in the repertory, there are very, very few remedies where cough is better by drinking water. Sometimes you may give causticum, but most important thing is that Saurusius Lapa is a important remedy. We all know Rumex, we all know Coccus cacti, we all know Spongia for drinking water. Spongia loves, of course, hot water, warm water. But this is a remedy which you should not ignore because it won't be there in the repertory. Other indications are offensive breath, chilly patient, flatulence. So with gastric concomitants, it's very chilly and the cough is very similar like cuprum. Because cuprum also loves drinking water, but that is cold, not warm like spongia. Scanty urine. I also use this remedy for people with emphysema and a gastric concomitant. And as usual, the patient in general is worse in a wet, damp weather. So sometimes, if there are symptoms of cuprum, symptoms of nux vomica and nausea, I think so psoriasis contains everything, okay? So frequent rubrics that I use in the repertory for cancer lung in my clinic, let me share some rubrics. So this is 72 remedies are there in the repertory for lung cancer, as you can see. Most of them are with 2 marks, 2 remedies are with 3 marks, okay? So 3 marks are arsenic, iodide and thalidomide, okay? And 2 marks remedy are very, very californicum, mureticum, carboplatin, methotrexate, cisplatin, radon, viola odorata, then lycopodium over here, and trusinum you can see on the top. After exposure to asbestos is cadmium iodide, remember that. Now when there's a croupy cough, I usually use deftalidom. See, because our hospital OPDs are very full. We get about 30 patients to 35 patients and we have got only 1.5 hours or 2 hours of OPD time. In that we have to finish so many patients. So your materia medica has to be on a tip. So the moment I see a laryngeal element or a croupy element, the prescription is naphthalinum 1x. Persistent chronic cough that refuses to go, codeinum and hydrocyanidinum hydrobromatum. It's another remedy. Read Burike if you want to know more about this. Racking cough. You know, the word racking means you get severe distress and anguish while coughing. We have got 119 remedies. This is a very common rubric because most of the cancer lung patients will have a racking cough. So use this rubric. I don't see many homeopaths using this rubric. Cancer of the bronchus, cough due to Bryonia, Conium, Ipecac and Calica, I use a lot. Rattling, when rattling comes, Calisulf, CPI and Timtart. When there's a fungal infection in the lungs along with cancer, Kaliiod. Cough worse lying down, Aurelia and Drosera. Worse laughing is Argentum metallicum. Nocturnal is Aurelia racemosa. Now please remember what I say is not always 100%. Sometimes other remedies also do come up. I am just projecting the one which I frequently use. So let me be very clear. And don't take this as a stuff written in your Bible or Bhagavad Gita. Okay? I'm just sharing my experience. Some other remedies will surely come. Somebody better by expectoration, iodium, ipica, guaiacum. Spasmodic element. I usually, when spasmodic comes, I use the 3x potency, naphthalinum, justicia, sanguinaria, drosera, and verbescum. These are the best remedy when somebody is coughing, then again stop, then again coughing, and the long bouts. When all remedies fail for the cough, pertussin. Cough day and night. Squila, Hydrastis and Carbo-Veg are very important. Cough constant at night, Conium. Tormentic cough inflicting severe physical or mental suffering when patient is exhausted, tired, desperate with the cough, Drosera ipica. Distressing cough, can you see over here? One that causes anxiety is known as distressing. And you will see Nux is a very important and commonly used remedy in my practice. Cough from cancer of the bronchus, again, Bryonia, Conium, Ipecac, and Kalicap. Expectoration bloody in the morning, Nux vomica. Effusion, very commonly seen. Collection of water between the pleura and the lung. Solanum aceticum, Lycopodium, Ars iodide, and Merck sulf. Dropsy that impairs the respiration. Person becomes excessively breathless because of dropsy. Ammon carb arsenic nitric acid works wonders. Respiration difficult. Cough during, it's a very large rubric. So you can use that. It's easy. Bloody expectoration from cancer of the bronchus. Ferumfos and Hevamelis tops the list. Even Arnica. Respiration difficult, exertion is a very large rubric. You can use it as a general rubric. Then respiration difficult sitting ameliorates. Now this is very commonly seen. Here you will see Antimtat, Kalicap is a very important remedy, and Palmo Vulpis. Good. Metastasis to the bones. General metastasis bone is another common rubric that I use. Equisetum arnes, Vitrum, Symphytum, Calcarea hypophos, Calcarea flor are important remedies. Next. Metastasis in the liver, curcumin, cyanidone, dactylon, thorium metallicum, myrica, these are some of the important remedy. Metastasis in the lymph node, you have got a long list of 41 remedies in the repertory. And general metastasis in the brain from the lungs. These are the remedy. You will see cuprum, veratrum, weed, crotalus, apis. Now there are some foods that will fight lung cancer. So let's see some foods which we advise. One of the things that we advise is the pears to eat, especially in non-small cell lung cancer. Green tea. Next. Salmon, if you are a non-vegetarian. Ginger, a lot of ginger. Especially we advise a lot of ginger and ginger-related products during chemotherapy. Capers. Even we give a lot of okra soup to make and drink during chemotherapy. Turmeric. Berries, carrots, tomatoes, watercress, and this is what we advise commonly to our lung cancer patient. And I think so, Kavita asked me something about FT in the mouth in a lady. So basically we give gargle of Rus glabra.
Thank you, doctor.
The person to gargle 2-3-4 times a day, it really removes the efters very fast. Okay, so that's all I have to share today's seminar.
Thank you so much, Dr. Farooq Master. It was very, very nice and so many new remedies. we all have learned. And would you like to take few questions?
Please. Five minutes for question, okay?
Yeah, please.
Let's start.
Hello?
Yes.
Yes. Dr. Sweta, would you like to... The screen is not shown.
You ask question on her behalf, no problem.
Any questions in the chat? Let me share this. I'm just trying to... I'm just checking in the screen. And Dr. Deepak or Regina, any questions you have in the chat or anyone, unmute yourself. We have a few minutes left.
Sir, I have a question.
Yes.
I'm Dr. Deepak from Delhi. Sir, in according to your experience, what are the frequency of the repetition in the pain? Because the pain is the worst symptom in every kind of third or fourth stage of cancer. So what will be the repetition of the potencies?
Okay, so Deepak, basically posology has to be directly linked with the susceptibility of the patient. Okay,
yes,
so there is no law, there is no rule. Every patient decides the posology depending on his or her susceptibility. If susceptibility is very good, then you can go for a medium potencies. If susceptibility is very poor, then you should only try very, very low potency. This is what I can say. Next question.
And what will be the frequency of repetition, sir?
Again, same. No, depending on the susceptibility. If it's good, you can frequently repeat. If it's poor, then please don't repeat more than 3 times a day.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
And some are asking mother tinctures, Dr. Farooq.
I don't use much mother tincture in my practice. So I'm not the right person to ask this question, because mother tincture usually acts at a physiological level, where our science of homeopathy is basically based on a dynamic level. And so the use of mother tincture is very little in my practice. Maybe I use calendula for injury or something like that, but nothing great.
So, sir, we are live on Facebook. So a common person is also hearing our videos and the lectures. So what you want to say to the general people who do not know about the homeopathy, then why should they use the homeopathy in the third or fourth stage of cancer?
Let them not use. One day they'll come back to you. You understood? If you have honey, the bees will come. Please remember that. So I don't advocate homeopathy to anybody in the whole world. When other things fail, they will surely come. Remember that. Huh? So we have that key. Okay. So best thing is, it's not that allopathy who never helps. Allopathic doctors do wonderful job. They cure like us. They palliate like us. Do you agree?
Yes,
people
sir.
Have cancer and they have never got recurrence of cancer for next 30 years of their life. So allopathy is not bad. We are not in competition. Please remember that. Neither
yes,
we are on a street fight or a fist fight with allopaths. Mm-hmm. Allopaths are our brothers and sisters. Where the role of a homeopathic doctor comes is when the allopathy stops helping the patient. When it stops helping, go for homeopathy. When homeopathy stops helping, go for allopathy. So we rather help each other rather than to create our own individuality that I am a homeopath and you are a oncologist. Okay?
And okay, this sir. Is again for the educational purpose. So though we are on the live, just we wanted to make sure that Dr. Farooq Master is whatever he has provided is for the purely for the educational purpose. So and they need to see the for the complaints professional practitioner.
Okay.
If we have so many questions coming up, Dr. Master.
One more.
Can I do that, Dr. Kavita?
Please. Go ahead.
Dr. Farooq, thank you. It was a wonderful presentation. I am stage lung cancer.
Oh, go.
I have, for 11 years.
Yes.
I operated right lung on 17 July, year 2008. The oncologist gave me 4 months, maximum 5 months of life. And now I have 11 years. I have hemoptysis every day for the past 11 years. I have shortness of breath. And I have been taking Ropaluro Junceus 30CH since I operated the lung.
But what are you taking? I didn't understand the name of the medicine.
Ropaluros Junceus 30CH.
Kavita, what is she saying?
Yes. So, Regina, can you please put it in the chat, please?
Okay.
Yeah, that way it's here.
It's coming from Cuba.
Okubaka.
And I will send you that what she's taking, Dr. Farooq.
Then I'm very happy that you are being feeling better.
But the cancer has made metastasis, doctor. It came back. I made a piece of the tumor that the doctor took in the surgery. It was a melon size tumor. And I made in the pharmacy the tumor 200CH.
Understood.
And then it came back and did metastasis into the other lung and to the right ovarium. It's very painful. I've been taking morphine, but my mind goes haywire. I would like if you please could suggest me. You also suggested the blisters on the mouth. You also suggest the medication. But something that I can...
It's not very easy to prescribe on one symptom like that. Where do you live? Which city?
In South America, Brazil, in Rio de Janeiro.
Oh!
You
should meet some local homeopaths and give your symptom, you know. Just to prescribe on pain without knowing anything about the patient is not very proper because... Nothing comes to my mind like that.
I understand, sir. Thank you so much.
Wish you best of luck and may God bless you and may you live long and happy and cheerful. Okay?
Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Master. It was very nice and thank you for your precious time. We have many, many questions and we will bring you back again. And I thank my team, everyone. And all the volunteers, and thank all the participants, and more special thanks to Dr. Farooq Master for taking his precious time for us. And we will see on July 25th with Dr. Divya Chhabra on her webinar at 9 o'clock, and we will send all the details. Thank you all.
Thank you all.
Thank you so much, sir.
Hey, wonderful, beautiful.
And see you all again. Until then, if you have any questions, please email us to carstudygroup@gmail.com. And Professor Regina, any of the car leadership or the volunteers will be able to help you. Thank you all. Have a nice day.
It was a great help.
Anything else you wanted to share before we end?
It was a great help, Dr. Kavita, especially on my condition and the rubrics and all personal experience enriched my life. Thank you so much.
So many rare remedies and so much information has shared. It was nice. Thank you all.
Bless your heart.
Bye-bye. Have a great
day. Bye.